Well, boys, looks like you started the fun without me.
You're all sick. Every last one of you.
We're going to need a bigger gun.
What's the matter? You scared of things that go boom?
Give me one goddamn reason why I shouldn't blow your goddamn brains all over that goddamn wall.
I'm Eric, and you're Michael. Since everyone's really concerned about what I'm drinking this week, I usually have an horchata on the show, but today I have a blueberry Izzy.
Are you allowed to say that?
Which is delicious. We have two films. Or
no.
One film and this Elizabeth Hurley vehicle that we'll talk about. What are those two aforementioned items?
You own Bedazzled, and then we're going to watch Gremlins.
Okay, Bedazzled and Gremlins, which we're going to spoil, I guess. I feel like I can't even give the same intro.
We're spoiling people by making them watch this movie.
By which you mean Bedazzled. We should be clear on this that you... Okay.
Like Gremlins. I own it.
Okay.
You like Bedazzled. You own it.
Man, so before we talk about Bedazzled... So, yeah, I own Bedazzled. Mm-hmm. All right. Let's get that out of the way. And Bedazzled
own
is...
it hardcore.
We haven't really talked about the why we're doing this show since the first episode. But in case people need some catch up.
Wait, there's episodes?
Yeah, there's what's a podcast?
What's a podcast?
Okay, I'll explain that to you after the show.
Do podcasts have chapters?
They do. We already talked about the chapters. They can skip this ramble right here and just go right into Bedazzled.
Okay.
Or skip Bedazzled, as I would probably encourage them to do, and just go straight to Gremlins.
So I have to admit that I feel kind of bad right now because one of our audience members owns Bedazzled, and I don't want her to think that I think any less of her because she does.
So I have to make myself feel less bad before I worry about the audience's opinion of us.
Well, I mean, she owns Bedazzled and that's all I know. Like, you own Eyes Wide Shut.
But I don't own Chasing Amy anymore.
Really?
Yeah, I got rid of it.
Score.
You're fucking getting me off my topic here. What was I going to say? Oh, so the whole nature of the show is really weird because it's definitely not tailored to, like, we have an audience of like as many people are in this room right now, maybe like 6 or 7. My point was that we didn't set this up to, because if we wanted a show that like we're going to try and get people to listen to, well, we'd probably do reviews, right? Mm-hmm. And we'd probably do like the hottest movies
and
that come out every
week. And we'd
have
a rating system.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And instead we just like, we talk about films that the other person hasn't seen.
Yeah.
Which will become really relevant for Bedazzled, I think.
Oh, I thought you were going to say will become really relevant later on in the like podcast. I'm like, we're on week 30, dude. It's not going to become relevant now.
I feel like I like having a project that doesn't cater to
anybody.
Well, yeah.
Even the people like involved in the project.
Right. It's pretty much, you know, it's something that we've decided to do and other people are going to find it.
I'm only using it as a vehicle to make you watch all my slasher films with me.
Well, so that works for you.
Works great.
And I'm kind of using it to record shows.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that people see in their iTunes, they're going to see Bedazzled and Gremlins pop up and go like, what the hell are these guys doing? That's totally acceptable. Mm-hmm. I'm all right with that. So let's talk about Bedazzled.
Okay.
The reason I mentioned that thing in the intro about the kind of like the idea of why we do the show is also we're kind of curious about people who just saw a film versus like the idea you have about a film years later.
Mm-hmm.
And occasionally we've done this actually with probably the two worst movies I own, Chasing Amy and now Bedazzled.
Well, we also did, I'm sorry, I don't know what you're going to say.
Oh,
I'll bring it up later.
Are you going to preempt my thought?
Yeah.
Well, my point was that both of those movies I had only seen once.
What about From Hell?
And From Hell I've watched a couple times.
Okay. I didn't know.
No, maybe I don't remember. Go back to the show. I'm
like
sure we talked about
it. When we were watching it, you said something like, I haven't watched it since I was 13.
Yeah, I might have not
seen it. But you say that about pretty much everything. I haven't eaten since I was 13.
Well, the bad stuff, right? That's my excuse for owning bad stuff is I see it at the time and maybe I don't even think anything of it. But when I started collecting DVDs, I probably went by Bedazzled in my head and something clicked and I said, I need to own this movie for some reason. And I didn't actually watch it. As another great thing that this podcast does is allow me to weed out all of these shitty movies that I am embarrassed to show you in my library. This one, Chasing Amy, first of all, Chasing Amy, just you and I watched. Bedazzled, we drugged 5 to 10 people through.
Drugged.
And I feel bad about that. So Bedazzled is a film directed by Egon from the Ghostbusters.
Bedazzled is directed by Egon.
So you would say no film on this? Not a film?
No, not a film.
What's missing from the Fargo checklist here to make this a film?
Plot?
Come on, there's a plot.
What's the plot?
Okay, the plot is, you gotta at least give it credit because stole the plot from the 67 film.
What's the plot?
The plot is Elliot's really dweeby and unsatisfied with his life. and he meets the devil who wears lots of different outfits, and she grants him wishes. And then in the end, he realizes he just wants her to be happy and that they totally won't work together.
Okay, that's so the here's the thing. Not unsatisfied with his life until he meets the devil. Totally like comfortable and like oblivious to the fact that like he's a nerd until he meets the devil, in which case he's like, you know what?
No, I'm unsatisfied with my life. Okay, yeah, you're right. No plot. It says in the opening credits, like he's lonely and he likes this girl who totally kind of shoots him down.
Also Steve Buscemi, not in it. So Fargo checklist. Sorry.
Okay.
You need Steve Buscemi to be a film.
You'll acknowledge that this has a plot, maybe not a great one.
No,
someone wrote this film.
The plot changes throughout the film.
It does. Yeah.
That's what I mean. Like,
well, because
in Fargo, there's an end goal.
Uh-huh.
In Bedazzled, there's a start goal and then various goals throughout the film.
Well, the end goal is to make you laugh.
The point of the film where I realized that it's starting to wane for me is when there was a point in time where the goal of the film was to have a bigger winky.
Harold Ramis is known for a lot of earlier comedy stuff that's like really well received.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Worked on Caddyshack, worked on Groundhog Day, which is that film that we've all seen on TV like 10,000 times.
No, just one time.
So he's done a lot of stuff that people say is good. I don't know. That stuff's too old to be kind of relevant and therefore funny to me. So I never really got into that. Have you seen any of that older stuff?
I have, but I can't think of what all he's done. I've also seen films with like him in it other than Egon.
Well, half of his body of work is like Ghostbusters spinoffs.
Uh-huh.
He does a lot of writing on especially the early comedy stuff and then more directing and acting later in his career. But he also did like Analyze This and Analyze That and a lot of films that kind of just failed more recently.
Mm-hmm.
So I start to wonder if he was ever actually good at his job. You wanted to talk about Elizabeth Hurley a little bit.
I wanted to debate about Elizabeth
Hurley. Because when I go back to what the reason was that like grabbed me 5 or 6 years ago to buy this DVD and like set it somewhere and never actually see it, I want to say it was probably Elizabeth Hurley's outfits.
Yeah.
And just like,
well, I would
probably in my head went, oh, there were funny outfits in that film.
Right.
$5. And then
I bought
it.
Not giving this film any credit. But I definitely think that like the makeup jobs for Brendan Fraser are notable.
Yeah,
they're
for sure.
Fantastic. I mean, because I'm a horror guy. So makeup is like, whatever you can't.
But for making a person look normal and different in each scene, I think they did a pretty good job of that. I think that's really all that's redeemable here.
Like, I mean, as a horror guy, like you can't top horror film makeup.
Sure. There's a lot more to hide under though. I mean, usually less so in the recent stuff, but I mean,
well,
when
Brendan Fraser isn't the kind of guy that you can like hide. He kind of looks like Brendan Fraser all the time.
Well, and so Brendan Fraser is obviously bad in this. I would compare him to like Rob Schneider kind of went out of fashion. Like, I don't think he really does stuff anymore, but for the last 5 or 6 years, he's been churning out these movies.
And now I think Tyler Perry.
Yeah. I think Brendan Fraser was kind of just the guy before that to do these. He's done some okay stuff, but most of his stuff it's bad, like physical comedy stuff or stuff like Bedazzled. But Elizabeth Hurley, I mean, I don't think she's good in this either. Like, I wasn't trying to make... Well, okay.
Is she an actor? Or is she just like a face?
I think she might be a model.
Okay.
That could be what it is. I believe maybe she's British and that's what her...
Yeah, that was really unattractive as well. I thought I'd be all into that.
What I like about Elizabeth Hurley in this film, though, and this is where we have a disagreement, is that I don't like her. I mean, if I have to watch a film that's trash like this...
Yeah.
I want something to carry me through it. And sometimes how bad it is can do that.
Yeah. So I'm going to just digress and clarify that what we're about to be arguing is whether Elizabeth Hurley is the kind of bad that makes the bad film more bearable or just the kind of bad that like hinders the badness of the film. Okay.
So what are your thoughts?
I think that Elizabeth Hurley was really annoying and I would have found the film much more enjoyable if she wasn't.
Okay.
It.
So for you, it was annoyance. It's the kind of thing where
she's really, really bad.
But that
and,
bad.
I mean, we've gone over like over and over in the show, like whenever there's actors, I'm always the first one to pick on it or pick them out. And I'm just going to do that. Like she's really, really bad in this film.
But is there a kind of bad that you find enjoyable or is that just something that you can't get into?
Not in this film. No, she's bad.
Right. But there are other films where a character is like so awful, you can just watch how bad they're being and that'll work for you.
You know who really does that for me?
Who?
When we get to Texas Chainsaw coming up, Dennis Hopper in the sequel.
Really?
The Texas Chainsaw. Yeah, Dennis Hopper is in Texas Chainsaw Massacre
like
2.
Like fire coming out of a monkey's head, Dennis Hopper?
Yeah, fire actually comes out of a monkey's head in that film.
He's not good in it? But you like Dennis Hopper, right?
I do. No, he's good in the beginning, but eventually he reverts. I'm not going to tell you what the line is, but he reverts to a single line and then proceeds to do a single action for the remainder of the film.
Okay, so something I should point out, James Brown reference.
Yeah.
While we've just given up on keeping straight to this film.
Yeah, who cares?
They make a reference, they make a couple weird references that are kind of out of place.
Like Barbara Streisand?
Well, yeah, or the Scientology thing. Just yeah, that was like, where did fucking, that come from?
That was like, you know what's funny? Scientology.
Yeah, right.
Kind of like, you know what's funny? Christopher Walken.
Yeah, a little bit. But they made the James Brown selling his soul reference, which reminded me a lot of the BMW film stuff.
Yeah. Which is good.
Yeah, there's a series of shorts that Clive Owen was in. They're all like 5 or 10 minutes long that were kind of meant to promote BMW cars, and BMW. They're on the internet and stuff. You should go check them out. But there's a really good one with James Brown, Marilyn Manson, Clive Owen, Danny Trejo. Oh, fuck, I'm missing somebody.
You're missing the devil.
Yeah, fucking Gary Oldman. God damn it. Yeah, so see that. Instead of seeing Bedazzled, see that film.
Yes. It's like called Chase the Devil, right?
Yeah. It's 10 minutes long. It's the end of the like season 2 they did of that. And it's really good.
It's really good.
To get back to Bedazzled, I did want to talk about one of the little short things, because the movie attempts to be humorous. And I think we would agree that it's pretty much humorous when Toby Huss is on the screen. Toby Huss.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Stumpy from Carnival. We talk about Carnival like every other show. It really is so good. He has a couple of the funny moments in this film.
What
do you think the two funny moments are in this film?
Well, he has runner-up funniest moment in the film where he plays Brendan Fraser's gay lover.
Uh-huh.
And he puts his feet up in the air and he's all like fruity and weird. And
for me, that's only funny because I know the other acting roles he's done.
Well, no, yeah. because I was just imagining it was Stumpy who had been Encino Manned into the 2000
right.
from the 30s. But then his other funny role, which like totally doesn't fit the film at all.
And it's like 5 seconds.
Yeah. Where
physical comedy.
Brendan Fraser grabs Bob and he's like, nice talking to you, Bob. And then
that was a good Brendan Fraser, by the way.
Then Bob walks away like all scared. And then Stumpy's like, oh, I'm standing in a place.
Yeah, everyone kind of empties out of the room and he just sort of sinks
just
down.
Like ducks behind
which
the cubicle.
Which was probably
wall.
In an hour and a half the first time I laughed.
The other thing is like, that doesn't fit the film.
No.
Not even remotely.
Well, at that point, you're kind of just trying to find a joke wherever you can get it, which is why
think that's true. I'm pretty sure the film thought it had everything going.
Well, so that's why I mentioned this, because I think a lot of the comedy in this just, it comes down to, again, with comedy, it's stuff you find funny or stuff you don't. But I think a lot of the things it aimed to do, I mean, in each of the little wish segments, they kind of try to go for this sort of mockery of whatever he's wishing for. And I think that comes across strongest in the basketball thing, where it's supposed to be satire and is probably the best example of why this film fails. Because when you have a piece of satire, you can't just recreate the original element. Because I mean, all we were watching in that segment is literally a basketball game. I mean, it's almost indistinguishable.
We're watching Space Jam.
Well, yeah. I mean, yeah, there's a couple like thematic elements they kind of throw into it, but there's no real jokes to it. There's nothing that's really satirical about it. It's kind of just a copy of a sports program. And you can't just like put basketball into a movie and be like,
it was a basketball montage.
They played up on the announcers.
Yeah.
And on the fact that Brendan Fraser was kind of dumb, right? That he didn't think there was an eye in team and that he gives 110%, which are just things that when you watch interviews with athletes, especially the ones who aren't too bright, that's really just what they say. That's not really satirical. It's kind of just what's happening anyways. Mm-hmm. And I think in the satire, a lot of this film failed. Had the satire worked, I think I would probably still enjoy this film this film.
I think a big failure for the film for me, the first like dramatic one,
right,
is the Colombian drug lord not being just Once Upon a Time in Mexico.
That's all I saw.
I was just watching Once Upon a Time in Mexico.
Yeah.
Can't we just get Willem Dafoe to do this?
And the other thing with the Carpe says, the other thing that the film attempts to do beyond satire is just try and present 7 cool little short segments. And I think it only goes downhill from the Colombian drug lord thing.
Yeah, that's
like, I don't think that one's even very good.
No, but it's probably the strongest one.
Yeah, and they just stop from there. So probably the most pressing issue to talk about here, if you've managed to sit this much through the podcast, is why people see these films.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So we're watching this film today.
This is the only valid part of this segment, I think.
There are 6 people here. Literally everyone but you had seen this film.
Yeah. What the fuck?
I'm not sure. I can't answer that question.
But that happens all the time.
I'm going to go with I was young. That's my excuse.
But so I was fucking young too.
I know.
I was older than some of the people here and younger some of the people here. And I didn't see this movie.
Well, so I don't know if I've like pointed this out on the show before. I think I mentioned it once, but I only started watching movies about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
I think I mentioned it around the Donnie Darko stuff.
Yeah.
In Memento, right? Because we didn't do Donnie Darko. We did Memento. Memento and Donnie Darko are like the first two films where I was like, hey, film is cool. I should see a lot of these.
Yeah.
And before that, I kind of just like went to movies on the weekends with friends. That thing that like I despise in moviegoers now and yeah. why like-
Well, I never like-
Why Eddie Murphy comedies like top the box office all the time.
Why Eddie Murphy with Eddie Murphy in the Eddie Murphy comedy.
Right.
Where films where it's just a picture of Eddie Murphy doing a stupid, goofy smile.
Right.
And the cast on the top where it's supposed to be block print and it's supposed to say Christian Bale, Heath Ledger, and fucking Aaron Eckhart.
Right.
Instead, it says Eddie Murphy, right. and Eddie Murphy as the clone.
Right, exactly. Yeah, and I went and saw those films, and that's why I've seen Bedazzled. There was a time in my life where that was acceptable.
That was never anything, like, I never did that.
I didn't know better, Michael. I personally apologize.
I understand that a lot of people did that. That was never, like, see, here's the thing, and here's where I think it's going to be obvious where our film tastes have come from.
Uh-huh.
What I did when I went to see movies with friends is I didn't have all that many like friends that would go see movies with me.
Yeah.
And I always went to see horror movies to laugh at them.
Oh, really?
That's what I did.
So here's where the problem comes in is all my movie going experiences from when I was younger were with girlfriends and I'm a total pussy.
Yeah.
So I couldn't go to the horror movies because I would scream and cry.
I would go see every horror movie that came out in theaters because I thought they were funny.
Well, I think stuff's gotten a lot better since then, though.
We haven't watched.
You don't think so?
Dude, think about these slasher series we've done.
Yeah.
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Uh-huh.
We have the first film, which is fucking great.
Right.
Second film, great. Third film, great.
Yeah,
New Nightmare came out in 93.
Okay, but to look at that period of the 90s, I mean. I think it's the 90s that fell short with horror stuff.
Yeah.
Most of the we're now talking about horror in the Bedazzled. This is our podcast. This is perfect. It fell really flat in the 90s. And you have the stuff more recently, especially the self-aware stuff or this like new American horror kind of thing.
Which never shows up anymore. That was like a fucking blip on the radar.
Thing that was like, hey, this is going to be cool.
Yeah. I hope it revives.
Keep your fingers crossed. The important thing is that there's no reason to own Bedazzled 8 years later.
Right.
So I'm going to get rid of that now. And awesome. I encourage anyone who listened to this and remembered that Bedazzled was bad.
All right.
To also get rid of it. Or if you like Bedazzled, keep it. I could just be totally wrong.
Yeah.
The things one of our friends mentioned before is that it's probably like peer pressure. These are the kind of movies that people see in groups.
Yeah.
I think.
The reason that I totally agree with you is because when there was a film that came out.
Uh-huh.
Called The Incredible Hulk, and it came out the same weekend as this other thing that showed up in theaters. Well, it didn't really show up. It kind of happened in theaters. I'm not going to say what it was. I just don't want to. So there's this film, The Incredible Hulk, that came out, and then something else. And all of, like, a group of friends of mine, Laura and Dave and Jeremy, Emily, and David, everybody, were all like, let's go see this. And at first, it seemed like a really good idea.
Right.
And then the day of, people were like, let's go see the Hulk.
Right.
And I was one of the people that was like, no, you know, let's not go see that. Like, you guys have already seen, some people had seen the Hulk earlier that
day. Yeah, right.
So I was like, no, we'll see this other thing.
The other bad Eddie Murphy type.
Yeah.
The bad film.
We get to the theater and the bad film is sold out.
Right.
And as soon as that happens, I'm like, wait. I'm about to spend $10 on something that I'm totally aware is going to be bad. Let's go see The Incredible Hulk. And by this point, everybody's like, no, let's go not and
see this other movie.
And we went and saw it. And
you're regretful, I think is the word.
I'm furious.
Well, and so what it is you're in a group of like 10 people and it's a snowball effect. Someone says, hey, maybe we should see this. And opinions start changing. Somebody's in the mood for something else.
Somebody starts walking backwards.
Right. And eventually you all end up theater seeing something fucking awful. And maybe that's, you know, as we're constantly on this quest to figure out why bad films still exist and are seen in vast numbers, maybe it's just easier to get all of your friends to see them. Maybe that kind of mass appeal allows a really diverse group of people who are all together at, you know, one point to all purchase tickets. And that's why Eddie Murphy still has a career.
Okay.
The one thing I knew about Gremlins going into this Because it's an 80s film. It's like from that mid 80s kind of like Goonies period. And I'd never really saw any of that stuff, which is why this is notably absent from movies I've seen. This is actually the place that whole myth about people committing suicide more frequently during the holidays comes from. There's no occurrence of that myth anywhere before Gremlins. But that was literally that and I knew Gizmo.
Yeah.
And that was it. Those were the two things. Which Gizmo, this would be the other reason I've never seen Gremlin. I know everyone thinks Gizmo's really cute. He freaks me out. I'm really, all of them, they're creepy. They make my skin crawl. So we have the Eddie Murphy thing, which I wanted to bring up because we had to talk about Eddie Murphy a ton in the Bedazzled segment for mm-hmm. some weird reason. So we have two Eddie Murphy connections here. One of which is that Eddie Murphy and Judge Reinhold, obviously, that's a lot that needs to be said about that. But also that Chris Columbus wrote this, who's also done such masterpieces as Christmas with the Clumps, which I believe was also referenced in the last film. There's other people we could talk about cast-wise. The kid, who I won't even...
Corey
Feldman.
Not Corey Feldman, that's not his name. I mean, that is his name, but that's not the name. It's Tommy Jarvis.
This was like Howie Mandel's big early work to voicing Gizmo before he became infamous for Deal or No Deal.
Oh, yeah. And being bald when a man shouldn't be bald.
It's like 50-something. It's a good look for him. I want to talk mostly about Chris Columbus because I've ragged on him a lot. As a director, right? He's mostly a producer. He's produced a lot of stuff after kind of the 80s period. He started his career in the 80s doing, the Goonies stuff. On this, all the nostalgic 80s films. And then he kind of had a big break where he just did production stuff for a couple decades and then kind of came back into directing. He's done a little bit of directing stuff here and there too. And last time we brought up Chris Columbus, it was to rag on his direction style.
Yeah.
I think it was the 12 Monkeys podcast.
Yeah.
Just for the, because of Slow Zoom. But as a writer, I mean, that's what I have to credit Gremlins 4. Mm-hmm. I think the strongest aspect of that is the writing. Mm-hmm. The direction on this isn't bad either.
I mean, but it's really simple direction.
It's the guy who did Small Soldiers.
Joe Dante, maybe?
Yeah, that sounds right. You know, you have a handful of scenes that I thought were really satisfying. You have just stuff that's kind of creepy, stuff that kind of gives it a little bit of a weird edge, which is really complimentary to a film like this. Mm-hmm. A lot of times I'll mention that in a film that doesn't have a lot going for it. But I felt like this was a film that kind of worked hand in hand with some of that camera work. You have, specifically, I'm thinking of a lot of the weird kind of 45 degree angle shots that are done kind of from further up, just stuff coming upstairs, looking in a refrigerator, weird different shots like that. A lot of, during the climax of the film, a lot of those shots, specifically outside, we have our two protagonists walking through what reminded me of the Silent Hill game. Just really emptied, kind of deserted, bleak city. Or when they're all in the theater and you have that kind of projector shot.
Yeah.
Which is probably my favorite frame from the entire film. Which is really cool because you have maybe two or three shots in the film where you see the massive group.
Yeah.
It's mostly just kind of chaos.
Yeah.
On a smaller scale. And you have a lot of close-up shots. Mm-hmm. Specifically a lot of like face shots.
Yeah.
But a couple times you get big pullbacks of all the creatures. And, you know, this is 1984. So the visual effects are of the mid 80s era. Mm-hmm. And we have shots that really still hold up today. Again, that projector shot is still like fucking creepy and stuff that looks like, you know, movie from the 80s. What I think this film on a whole is really notable for is that it's got this dark comedy thing to it. Especially dark comedy about like Christmas, right?
Ridiculously dark. And yet for some reason, like, I don't know if you were going to go there, but I think that the film's shining, crowning moment of dark comedy, like you're going through the film and the first time you think, oh, wow, this is a different kind of film is when the old lady just shoots out of her window.
Right.
I love that.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's just because it's an old lady shooting. Could happen like on the street today. And I would think that was hilarious.
Okay.
But
or shooting off a bus, maybe.
Yeah, that'd be even better. Especially if she was fucking yelling at me for sitting in the handicap spot.
Anyways.
Another day. But furthermore, the scene where the female protagonist is talking about her dad.
Yeah, for sure.
Why she hates Christmas. And they go into it in the beginning. Like, I'm the only one that hates Christmas. Right. And like now, when like here in the 21st century, like one out of every three people hates Christmas.
Yeah, right.
I mean, I'm sure of the people in this room.
More than one out of three in this room hates Christmas.
That's like something that's dispelled. But in the film, it was probably like weird and you had to kind of figure out why.
Yeah.
And it's this thing where you're kind of expecting, because she's handling it in a really like grave, heavy sense.
Sure.
You're expecting it to be this really grave thing. And in any other film, it would have been.
Yeah.
Gremlins, the delivery is so deadpan.
Yeah.
But the like story is so stupid. Like, come on.
Well, this is really classic black comedy. It was black comedy in the 80s until Ice Cube movies started coming out. And now black comedy, it clearly has a different term. Mm-hmm. But at the time, what they would have called black comedy.
Yeah, right.
We've only maybe seen one or two other kind of dark comedies on the show. I really wish we would have paired this with Bad Santa because the parallels are ridiculous.
Yeah.
But especially around the holidays, these are always great for Christmas movies. And I think Gremlins may have been the beginning of this trend. Mm-hmm. You see it again in the 90s with Nightmare Before Christmas, this kind of backlash against Christmas culture.
Yeah.
Because box offices are just flooded during Christmas with these, you know, Christmassy feel-good films. And you have people that don't want to see that. Whether they're, you know, like our female protagonist in this film, they don't like Christmas because of a tragic event that happened to their father, or don't believe in God, or tired of being with the family and need to get away. And so you have films that come out like this, which, I mean, the dark comedy genre just ties in so well with Christmas films. You get this almost kind of hybrid of Halloween and Christmas, which they even point out a little bit in the film when shit starts hitting the fan.
Yeah.
And they go to the radio host. Well, I always just want to be the guy in Vanishing Point now.
Yeah. Super soul.
And you get the guy calling in and, you know, he's like, this is Christmas, not Halloween or whatever. Mm. And when you fast forward 10 years into the 90s, Nightmare Before Christmas took over that in every sense of the word really, or the term. You have, from a marketing standpoint, you have the memorabilia. I mean, it took over this part in culture that I think Gremlins kind of tackled for like a decade. Mm-hmm. And we haven't really had too much of that recently. I would maintain that Bad Santa is that, but no one would buy that. People forgot about that film like 2 years after it came out. But I think it's about time for another one of those. We're about ready to close out the decade and I'm kind of waiting for the dark comedy Christmas movie to happen.
Yeah.
So from a writing standpoint, which is why I launched into this whole thing, I think Columbus nails it with this one because you have characters that have an amount of depth to them, but not an amount you don't want and not force fed to you. And even in kind of a gimmicky way, you know, you have the dad who's this inventor, which totally works throughout the film. I mean, I love just the idea that could almost carry a movie on itself. It's the kind of thing that you wouldn't want to carry a movie on itself, which is why it's here.
Well, because if it carried a movie on itself, it would be starring Judge Reinhold.
Right, probably.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting, too, to look at this movie, which already has, I hate to use the word gimmick, but it's got something iconic to it. You have Gizmo, right? Mm-hmm. You have the Gremlins. That's really all you need. But on top of it, you have these characters who almost like are on the back burner, right? It's not even really their struggle. It's kind of the Small Soldiers thing again, you know? Small Soldiers was a film in the mid-90s, early 90s, maybe.
Yeah. That has a recurring character from Gremlins. You're aware of this.
Which is which one?
The crazy drunk guy, the Reds are infecting our cars with Gremlins.
Oh, yeah.
Is
the guy
that kind of gives him the shipment of toys.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Same guy.
Yeah. Well, there's another movie where you have this like soldier battlefield. You have these toys fighting and the humans are kind of just an afterthought, which is what you're dealing with here. But your human cast in this is still pretty good. The female lead, even if her only purpose is to deliver what seems to me the iconic dark comedy moment, because you have, you know, I mean, what more could you want? That's
really
it.
Yeah.
That's like, it's the ultimate amount of tragedy, but in a laughable situation, which is again, classic dark comedy. You have something that would be really hard to deliver with a straight face. And the fact even that it's just the deadpan makes it work.
Right.
You know, if that actually happened to you, how do you say like my father died because I got stuck in the chimney
if that happens,
have it not be a fucking joke?
Just like in the hypothetical situation that were a true story.
Right.
I would feel so awful for that person because they tell the story and they have to tell it either like, haha, yeah, no, I know it's kind of funny.
Yeah.
And belittle the death of their father.
Yeah.
Or they have to tell the story and everybody laughs at them. Or they have to tell the story without laughing.
Yeah.
That would be my problem.
Right. I hope your dad doesn't listen to this podcast.
My dad doesn't know what a podcast is.
Oh, and then your background of the male lead and, you know, the relationship with the dog or whatever there, identifiable role, not a whole lot to say about that, but specifically the dad and these inventions, which you see sprinkled throughout the film.
Yeah.
I think that's particularly effective in the beginning when you just see the catastrophe that they're all causing. Like, none of these things work, right? Which is funny. It's kind of prop comedy. It's kind of physical comedy, but it's still really funny.
Well, it's all the same prop comedy, though, where it's just the machine and you try to work it and it works for a second and something, then something splatters on you.
Yeah, yep. That's exactly what it is. I really like that idea, though, of just like being married to someone who makes shitty inventions and you kind of have to use them because you don't want them to feel bad. So even something as easy as like blending something or juicing something or making eggs.
My favorite invention of his, like the one that I just can't comprehend, is the coffee maker.
Uh-huh.
Like, it's a fucking coffee maker.
Right.
It's the same thing. It just pours it into a cup instead of a pot.
Right.
So like, why don't you just get a fucking coffee pot?
Yeah, for sure.
Like, instead of this guy's goo producing, like, unless you're into the goo.
It somehow produces
I would probably opt not to have the goo.
No, right. Well, you're an elitist coffee aficionado. Well, so clearly, when it comes to tar in your coffee.
When it comes to goo, dude, it's just...
Opt out. Gotta opt out on that
one. Opt out of the goo.
So the invention stuff just kind of plays as a backdrop to kind of, really just to kind of make the house more interesting and the characters... The bulk of the story is the Gremlins.
Uh-huh.
And I think just to look at that story on paper is where it's good. Mm-hmm. You know, in execution, it could go a lot of different ways, but it's not like someone took an okay story and really amped it up. I mean, that's something. And that's, again, why I mentioned Chris Columbus specifically, because I think it had to look good on paper. Yeah. It's a really original story, but it plays on cliches that I think are okay. And especially for the Indiana Jones kind of generation of like this sort of Eastern mysticism creatures.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a creature and you're given three cardinal rules about it, which I think is great. I like that.
It's hilarious.
It's part of the roadmap thing we've talked about before.
It would suck if it were serious. Like it would be awful. But I mean, come on. Kid's a little gremlin guy.
Right. Well, you know, it's a bit tongue in cheek since the first time you see him. You're given these three rules and, you know, of course, they're going to be broken. And so that sort of gives you your layout for the movie. You kind of know where this is going to go just from the beginning, which is good. But then they get it back and you're kind of still, all you know is there are three rules. You don't know what they do. A lesser script could have spelled that out for you to kind of give you a bigger sense of danger.
Mm-hmm.
Had it said, you know, if you feed them, they'll turn evil.
Yeah.
Well, then you'd already know that. There'd be no enigma there.
Right.
But I think a lot of movies kind of go for that choice because they want you to feel threatened.
Yeah, the only one they let you know is the sunlight will kill them.
Right, which is relevant in the end. Mm-hmm. You know, that kind of sets up your...
Well, the fact that they tell you that sunlight will kill them, like, eludes the, the deadly hamster style.
Right, like, exactly.
Because if they're just like, also don't let them see sunlight and you're, you know... 4/5 of the way through the film and all the other rules have been broken.
Right.
You're like, I wonder how they're going to kill Stripe.
Well, when you deal with, I don't want to call it a monster film, but you know what I mean.
It's a mock monster film. That's why I own it. That's why I love it. Like, it takes one of the genre of films that I love with Feast and The Descent.
Yeah.
And it goes, these are kind of dumb.
Right. You want them to kind of give you the how to kill the monster because otherwise we have... The Freddy problem, right?
Yeah.
Which is like, it turns out he can be killed like this and now we kill him.
Yeah.
And you don't want that to just show up at the end because it's bad writing.
Right.
We're really critical of the hamster style thing on other films too. But this is a case where I think it's really warranted. You know, this is something where you want it.
They kind of elude it by telling you what it is.
Right.
They don't kind of say it and then hide it and then bring it back and then it's this magic savior. Yeah. It's like, this is what will save you.
I think you have three options with that, right? You can go three different ways with the killing
monster.
Is
this two and a buffer or is this actually three?
No, this is, I really got three. I started out with three. I don't have two and a buffer. Your first one is this way. You give them you kind of drop it in maybe sort of subtly or pretty blatantly in the beginning. You say, this is how you're going to kill it. And in the end, you have to kill it. And that's the method you use, which is fine. Your second method is the exploration method, which is you have a creature and now you have to spend the movie figuring out how to kill it.
In a abbreviated sense from Dusk Till Dawn. Okay, we're dealing with vampires. What do we know about vampires?
Sure, right. I think Feast didn't necessarily do that so much. I'm trying to think of a good example we've done on the show, and I don't think we have one. Because when you have a movie that's solely about how do you kill the monster, usually that doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there are examples where it has, I just got nothing.
Yeah.
Your third is kind of the, it doesn't matter, which is sort of the Cloverfield thing.
Right.
Which is there's a big monster, somebody else is taking care of it, or it's just going to be there or whatever.
Get away from the monster.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's usually where those movies go. In the example of Cloverfield, it was the government's responsible for, they're going to take care of it.
Yeah.
It's not this, it's not a ragtag team that has to take down the monster.
It's not like the one person who knows the truth.
Right. Yeah.
I like how that's why Cloverfield is so effective, because nobody knows the truth.
Yeah.
Nobody fucking knows. Nobody.
Yeah, you don't have that day after tomorrow scene where like there's a guy in a board of director's room and he's like, we've got to do this. And everyone's like, silly scientist.
Yeah.
You don't need that. You know? Yeah. So you get past the three rules in the beginning of this film. And that pretty much sets up the tone as soon as they hatch.
Yeah.
It sets up the tone for the rest of it is going to be mostly comic mischief,
mm-hmm.
but in a very, again, a very kind of dark sense.
People die.
Yeah. It's comic mischief, but I think this is another thing you can do. Another kind of formula for dark comedy. You take heavy things. And of course you can do the opposite, but this movie chooses to take heavy things and make light of them.
Right.
So yeah, you have deaths in this that are really just thrown away. One of the characters carries around a revolver.
Where the exact opposite would be Death to Smoochie, where you take a light subject and make it incredibly dark and heavy.
Exactly. Which I think is another totally effective method.
Oh, for sure.
Go watch Death to Smoochie. It's really good. We should do it
on the podcast. When we get around to where we just start doing the films we like.
Yeah. When we've seen every conceivable film possible.
Yeah. We'll start doing Death to Smoochie.
But yeah, that's something where the basic one sentence premise of Death to Smoochie is you have a children's show and the movie is exploring the seedy underworld
of children's television.
Yeah, which is great. So you could go either way. And I think this is the way to go, especially when you're doing it with the Christmas theme,
mm-hmm.
because I think that lends itself more to, unless you're going to do the shady underpinnings of Christmas, which I don't think there's a movie there.
Mm.
That works for this. That totally works for this. And then you spend the rest of the movie giving this kind of like comic mischief. But when you look at these creatures, I mean, first of all, they're smoking throughout the film, which I thoroughly enjoy. Uh-huh. Just the fact that they all have cigarettes in their hands. I don't know if you follow, because I'm like an MPAA nut. We talked about that a lot in This Film Is Not Yet Rated. But shortly after Gremlins came out, and I don't know if you know this or not, there was kind of a backlash by media groups because it was violent, which seems a little weird in retrospect because you watch it now and it, again, I use the term comic mischief because that's what the MPAA calls it now, but they gave the movie a lot lighter rating than what a lot of parenting groups and, you know, people who think we need like government babysitters called for. And just months after the film came out, they like changed how they rate movies in response to Gremlins. Which I thought is also kind of ironic, because if this film were to be re-rated again today, the fact that they all smoke would have gotten the movie another lower rating, or another, I guess, stricter rating by the MPAA, because you're not allowed to smoke in films without that kind of rating anymore. So just the backlash against smoking has kind of made the movie even a little more like dirty. You know what I mean? It's more bad, and
I just like how the film starts, and like the score lends itself to this in the beginning, where it's all like, you know, yay, happy Christmas suburb time.
Yeah.
Everybody's happy. Like the only problem is that, you know, old lady Deagle is angry at your mutt.
Right.
And everything else is fine.
Right.
Nobody's doing anything wrong.
Sure.
And then these fucking gremlins come and they're like getting ridiculously drunk and smoking and like hitting each other with hammers and shooting each other. Fucking killing people.
They're breaking the parents' rules.
Yeah.
You know, they're misbehaving.
Yeah.
That's
they're,
what it is.
They're like this like debaucherous crowd of little green guys. And like, it almost seems like if they did a Gremlins film, like in the inner city, like people would be like, they're not so bad.
Yeah. Right. Well, you have them doing things that, you know, to children going to see the movie or to adolescents going to see the movie, which I think is probably a majority of the crowd that film is kind of geared towards because again, because of the Christmas thing, you have people are tired of family, which tends to be a younger crowd, I think. And to that crowd, you see behavior that's, you know, it's shady behavior. It's meant for older people. Mm-hmm. But as you kind of get older, or maybe even just the older crowd, people in their 20s and 30s and so on that went to see the movie, you're looking again at this behavior and you're catching the darker elements of the film, but also just the behavior in general is something that, you know, because you're dealing with Christmas in the film and you're dealing with kids in the film, right. It seems again, dirtier. It seems more like misbehaving. Yeah. And that just, it totally works here.
I'm assuming you've never seen Gremlins 2.
No, I was going to ask you about that. Can we close this out and you tell me a little bit about Gremlins 2?
Yeah. So Gremlins 2, it came out a little bit later and I will own it. So we will cover it on the show.
Sure.
But currently I mean, it's not on my high priority list of films to pick up.
Got it.
It's good. I like it better than this one.
Really?
It tackles different issues in a different way. It's still really dark. But it's dark and it's way funnier. And they kind of do something. They kick it up a notch with the Gremlins. They amp it up so that it's not just like, oh, giggly, laughy, crazy time.
Right.
And then you kill them again. They change stuff. I don't want to give it away.
Sure.
Because it'll be way more amusing to you when you see it. But
we'll do that soon.
It's a way more satirical thing about, instead of Christmas, something else.
Good. I look forward to it.
This is show 27.
Yeah.
Of the epic length that is the double feature podcast.
Right. Which will continue to go the with all six viewers.
Yeah.
Or listeners, rather.
But on show 30, which is three shows from now, if you can subtract, will be finally the Texas Chainsaw Massacre thing.
All right. We gave people a lot of heads up with that, but I think that's... There's how many movies again?
There's six, but you got to get through them all. Like, right. Unlike Jason, where you can sit down and a day is a long time, but it's totally like amusing and a blast. Texas Chainsaw, you need like, you know, six warnings.
Well, and we didn't really like have a good idea that, hey, maybe we should warn people in advance if we're going to make them watch a billion movies. So now you got some weeks notice here, so you should be okay.
Yep. We're going to cover all six of them.
No more Jesus Angel movies.
After next week.
Well, yeah, we've been in like this accidental rain of religious films the last, I don't know, month or two of the show. This just keeps happening.
Yeah.
I didn't even realize it again with Bedazzled.
I completely didn't consider Bedazzled.
So next week is the last of this.
Yeah. We are rounding out the Terminator 3, Prophecy 3 thing.
So how do you feel, just really quick, how do you feel about the way we chose to outline that? Because now we kind of have that all set up. I mean, to do the trilogies the way we did, effective?
I don't know how it's effective to listeners, but I know that every time I finish a Terminator movie, I just want to watch the next one.
Yeah, I know.
I don't know if that's the same with you in The Prophecy, but like every time.
It's possible that we should have just done these each as their own shows, but I don't know. We'll see how much we have to talk about on the next show. So write us angry emails, which is doublefeatureshow.com.
Yeah.
Go in there, click the thing.
Yeah.
Tell us you really love Bedazzled.
I think we have MySpace.
And also Facebook.
Facebook.
Great. Do all of those things.
Also watch more fucking film.
Bye.